We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk. American booty for sale in every nation. American booty for sale in every nation.
My booty. Look at your girl. Who taught you how to love her? Look at the world who's on the magazine covers. Pencil thin waist with commodified traits from the one African mother of the human race. Homogenized lover, glorified and white face. For quick cash, adding to the hype of the chase. Just sexual bait, yeah, she's fallen from grace. A nice dish to taste, just a bitch to waste. Whoa, a man who says bitch without context means he's got a complex. The word queen describes a woman best. But many men only understand conquest with no conscious contribution to evolution or progress. Gotta go through all this instead of being honest. Be sure the ladies, we know you want us. Do you know if you want the goddess or the prize? American booty for sale in every nation. American booty for sale in every nation. American booty for sale in every nation.
Mind, booty, and soul.
American booty for sale in every nation.
Greetings, greetings, everybody. I hope everybody had a wonderful, wonderful day. This is Mind, Booty, and Soul Live. We have a really wonderful show today. It's about definitely getting to understand the entertainment industry. Is talent necessary? All the tools that are being used today. And I'm welcomed by Jamela Cummings. We just had this conversation.
We did.
Yeah. And she's a PR specialist, public relations consultant at PR agency. And we have Rain Morton, and he should be on the line. See, Rain, are you there? You know, while we're finding Rain, we're going to get into net neutrality again. This is something that's very important for all of us and how we deal with the economics of the future. Televisions will be coming through your computer Wi-Fi system. The old traditional cable wires are going to be a little bit non-existent over the next 5 to 10 years. And so everybody has a level playing field now where I can compete with somebody like Time Warner based upon my content being relevant and actually attracting a large audience. But if net neutrality doesn't pass and doesn't go through, guess what? People like Time Warner, people like AT&T and the big corporations that have plenty of dollars, plenty of money, will be able to buy a faster, more economic lane, and they'll be able to have better type of product, more than just something that's television, more than something that's just music. They'll be able to probably have some type of 3D hologram, and I'll be standing on a 2D television set because I can't afford the bandwidth. So we really need to get behind this particular bill or non-bill that's going to be coming through the FCC. If you have any questions, or you should actually go leave a comment, go to the FCC.gov in the comment section and place your views. Okay, we're going to get right to it right now. Is Rain on the line right now? Hello, hello, hello. Well, we'll see what's going on with that. But, anyways, Jamela, how are you doing today? You know,
I'm doing fantastic.
Okay, okay.
Thanks for having me here.
So, now, when I brought up the whole idea that talent is no longer necessary, and you're, you know, a publicist, and I'm sure you're dealing with that every day in your field, what was the first thing that came to mind?
The first thing that came to mind was how true that is. Because, I mean, there's a few different ways that you can look at it. You can look at it as, is this something that's a new epidemic, or is it something that's been growing over time and now is more prevalent?
Mm-hmm.
And so I just started to kind of think about a lot of that earlier today, like what is it? Is it that it's new, or is it something that, you know, that we kind of have glazed over in the past and we didn't really address it today? But I think people now today are a little bit more vocal about their dislikes about the entertainment industry.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it's really thoughtful.
So caller, is this Rain?
Yes, man. Yes, sir.
Great. How you doing today?
I'm fantastically well, nearly spectacular. Thank you for having me on the show, man.
Well, thanks for, you know, coming on the show. I know you had a really busy schedule. So let's get right into it. You know, Rain, you're a really multi-talented artist. You know, back in the day, they would call you a triple threat. You can sing, you can dance, and you can act.
Stop it.
You know, they don't really cultivate those type of artists anymore. And recently, you just got picked up to play Bobby Brown in the new Whitney Houston bio. So that's congratulations. That's a big bro for you there, isn't it?
To correct you, to be specific, I'm in the running. They've got a group of possible hopefuls, and I've been told that I'm amongst that group. So I haven't quite yet got it, but I got it in my mind. So thank you for that, and from your mouth to God's ears. Yes.
Okay. Okay. Well, everybody, go check out Rain Morton. It's R-E-I-G-N-M-O-R-T-O-N. And he's got this really picture where he compares himself, as far his current picture, to Bobby Brown. I think you guys are wearing a similar suit. Oh, it's very, very close. It's amazingly close.
Man, I'm telling you, man, I'm just basically, I'm starting to... A pledge or like a trend, hashtag I be Bobby, and I'm Rain Morton. So like I think the things we want, the things we feel like we should have, we've got to already have it in our mind that it exists, and then the universe has no choice but to lock into that thought. So I'm thinking positively, and it's been working. Like I'm in a show right now with Quentin Tarantino. I've been trying to get you come out and check it out, Mike. You always are avid supporter of everything I do. You come out, and you know it don't matter if I tell you come to Timbuktu, you'll be there. And which I felt so bad I couldn't actually be in the studio audience, but I got tied up doing some work, and I really got inspired, and I want to leave the inspiration on the stove.
So, being the man who's been multi-talented, and, you know, like I said, you guys should hear Rain sing. You know, he's got a Brian McKnight voice, you know, he's got the charisma. So, what are some of the difficulties? Because you've been here in L.A. for quite some time, and in normal circumstances, you would have been signed, you would have had a big backing and promotion by a record company. These are different times. So, tell me your experience as far as you showcasing your talent and actually trying to get to the next level. Are you there?
Question, and I like the way you addressed it to me. I feel like, what is making it? We put, when we say making it, you know, it's different to different people. Now, we have what the media says is making it, and you quote-unquote successful. But I feel that if you find solitude and happiness and just inspiring, creating, and I realize that had I gotten a lot of the opportunities at a certain age in my life, at a certain stage in my life, of what I believed in and what my foundation was, I would have exploded and just spontaneous combust, and you'd be seeing me on the news doing this. You know, you see these celebrities have these breakdowns and these things that happen because they weren't ready mentally, spiritually, or emotionally to handle the abundance. So I'm taking my time, and I'm happy, and I'm making sure that everything I do, I believe in my work. And like I came out here like in 08, and you know, was working soap operas for 2 years. You know, just like it's like, you know, General Hospital. You know, it was something that kind of got me into, you know, working consistently, making a nice amount of money, but also being able to be placed at the feet of really seasoned professionals, not only in music but in television, film, and everything. So I'm in a long process of education, and I'm learning everything, and now things are falling into place beautifully. I'll be going to Montreal on the 21st, the Montreal Jazz Festival.
Oh God, I love that Jazz Festival.
Jill Scott, Maxwell, Beck. It's, you know, and I'm going to be performing all 8 days. You know, with my cast, and it's beautiful. You know,
that's wonderful.
I always say you should have a blueprint of who you say in the essence you want to be. Mine is Sammy Davis, and I don't know if a lot of you guys are familiar with Sammy Davis Jr., his story, but you know, his what he was able to do and what he had to do in the time that he was alive is unbelievable. Like, I watch him and I listen. He say, "If you got," I watch my grandmother used to have me watch, you know, like recordings that she had of Sammy Davis. And I just said, okay, you're supposed to be able to sing. You're supposed to be able to tap. You're supposed to be able to dance. You're supposed to be able to be funny. You're supposed to be able to hang a suit. That's just what you're supposed to be, because that's what I was exposed to. And so, you know, and it took him a while to kind of really, really find his place, especially in a world where faces didn't look like his.
Great.
And the type of stuff he had to endure. So, you know, I'm taking from the cloth of kings like that, try to really, you know, season my meal so when I place it in front of the people to eat, it's gonna nourish them.
So
does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense. But you know, we've always had this thing, especially in Los Angeles, it's not necessarily what you know, it's who you know. Mm-hmm. And that used to be really important, as far as, like, you know, there would be a lot of people that I would run who didn't know anything about video recording or really didn't have the equipment or the know-how, but they would actually get the deals and to actually get the money. So, you know, for you, was that always more important as far as having an idea? Jamela, was that important for you to actually, you know, it wasn't what... it was who you knew and your network, and was able to get access for your clients to get out there. Was that more important than their talent?
Yeah. I would say that public relations is probably 80% of who you know.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of getting your clients access to different things. But sometimes, if you're a really good publicist, you can just package it to a point where it's irresistible. So they have to pay attention to it if you're aggressive. But you do get a lot further with the who you knows, and that's why a lot of publicists like to have what they call an anchor client.
An anchor client.
So an anchor client is like a B-lister, an A-lister, a client that's doing something now that people want to talk about.
Okay.
Because then what you do is you barter. So you barter your other clients into, well, I'll get you this person if you do me a favor and get me this interview. So that's really how the inner workings of public relation happens, if you know what you're doing. So I would say, yeah, it is about who you know. And the more popular your client is, the more likable they are, the more they have to say, or the more handsome they are, the more doors open for them.
So, you know, with Famous in 12, this is something that the Harvey Levins, you know, the guy from TMZ, he's got the new show that's coming out. He's basically saying, you know, we need to create shock value. We need to create a spectacle. We need to make a scheming thing. You know, has things changed to where now it's all about trying to get the headlines, or is trying to get that viral attention?
Well, viral attention is very important. Viral attention is probably even more important than newspapers, than broadcasting. It's one of the most important mediums now that there is.
Why?
Well, it's something that consistently lives. It's national. It's international. People in China can look up the same thing that you want to look up now about the Kardashians. So it has a way of reaching people that a local newspaper won't do. And then people are just lazy on top of that. They don't want to pay for the newspaper. They don't even want to turn on the news because they think it's for old people. Yeah. So, you know, they want to go to exactly what they want to read about right when they feel like they want to do it. So the internet gives you the opportunity to do that. So that's why it's the most important medium now. I said, in entertainment world, second to the digital, it would be the dailies.
What do you mean the dailies?
Like, or the weeklies. So it would be like the Us Weekly, the People's, those things that kind of like turn over really quickly, but it's constant new content that comes out all the time.
But it's kind of funny, and Rain, you can chime in on this as well. I remember when tabloids used to be like, you know, the dirty little, you know, delightful thing that I'm going to do, take it in my back corner. I don't want anybody to see, because I saw you with a Star magazine, you know, you'd be like kind of, you know, talked about a little bit. Mm-hmm. So how did that?
Yeah, that's why they put it in the front of the, with the cash register. So when you're waiting and you're standing still, you can read. That's the only time you read it. I'd be reading the hell out of it for that 5 seconds.
Exactly.
I'm in line, and as soon as they say, do you have a Ralph's card? Then bleep, then I put it down. You know, so people still read them. It's another access of getting other types of information that, you know, may or may not be, you know, popular or fashionable.
Yeah.
But when did it become the main appetite?
I don't know. It's sensationalism, right? So people are obsessed with reality shows. People are obsessed with the star behind the star. Who is this person really, right? They want to really know, or have feel like they have the inside look into something that they don't. They want their life to be more exciting. And so they live vicariously through these people who they can't touch most of the time and they can't see, you know? So people in Ohio are like, well, what is Kim Kardashian? They'll never see Kim Kardashian ever in their life.
And they don't need
ever,
to.
Ever
in their life. So, but they're still intrigued by her because she's living this lifestyle right in front of us.
But I think that's the key right there. It's this lifestyle. And we know behind the scenes there's a lot of manufacturing that going on. And the whole thing about with Kim Kardashian and Paris Hilton, we've always had entertainers like that, but they really would come and they would go. And then they would come and go. And we would get this recycle. Well, now Kim has been here a good 7 to 8 years. Paris is still, you know, she's got her whole brand.
You know how to do this. Madonna used to do the same thing, man. She reinvented herself. Like, come that old, man. She reinvented herself through the guy she was laying down with to a certain extent. But, you know, when you don't have, like, outstanding talent, you find ways to stay validated by these shots. Madonna did it all back. Y'all, we forget how she was with Robin and doing all this crazy stuff with the book and the video.
That's true.
And then go back, and then she would have, then she'd have a baby or something and change the whole game on that. Then she'd get soup. Then she'll kiss a Britney or do something to kind of like remind you and reinvent themselves. And Kim, quite honestly, she's been able to do that through whatever salacious scandal or who she's dating. You know what I'm saying? But like, she just taking a page from Madonna's book, if you ask me.
Well, Madonna was in front of the camera and she was giving out music videos and she was singing songs and she had a fan base. But Kim is like, what product is she putting out besides, you know,
besides
her clothes that are tagging her name on it?
Well, I mean, the clothes are very subpar. I mean, they don't even really do that well.
It's one of the hugest,
musical talents,
legal scandals of all time with the OJ thing. She connected with that, so it's just a bridge gap between all these major things. And who she's dating, and like Kanye, I mean, good luck trying to find somebody who don't know who Kanye is, you know. And so you know, you go from all right, I'm gonna do the highest thing on this level, and then once I conquer that, okay, professional athlete, and not saying that no, she can't sing, no, she can't act, so I'm gonna find out something else. I'm gonna look this way, I'm gonna have my body this way, and I'm gonna be next to every, significant, when Reggie Bush shine and everything, on his arm.
But the only way that could materialize is that you had to have a wide variety of media outlets covering it. And that's, to me, was the expansion, the explosion of the tabloid industry. The Us Weeklies, the Stars, it was already there. But now they needed like a front page, prototype celebrity that they can cover. They can create this type of scandal. They can talk about her booty, and she's not black, but she's got a bigger booty than most people. There's these things that you can constantly talk about her, and that's what that industry needed. And along with Paris Hilton, to now their everyday life. But when it first happened, I don't remember us actually needing to see as much as Kim Kardashian. It was just like something, wow, she's there again. I guess the question was, she never went away. How is she continuing to appear on these magazines?
She got re-signed for another season 5 or 6 or however season for her show. Mm-hmm. And like, even though nothing was happening on the show, it was just like nothing. It was like, who cares? What soup your mom made? Nobody cares. But it's like she kept getting me, and I know how they do over there. E, I used to do countdown shows for E a little while ago, and it's like when they see something kind of, they're tastemakers, so they see something kind of hot, whether it makes sense or not, they're gonna keep it on and make you watch it. You know, it's like the radio. They make you make that favorite song. Even if you don't like it the first 6 times you hear it, by the 12,000 time you hear it, you're going to eventually say, oh, that's my joint. Oh, that's my song.
Here's a point.
That's what it's going to be.
Because the media is force feeding us. These programmers are force feeding us. They put millions of dollars mm-hmm. behind Keeping Up with Kardashians. Oh, right. They have huge staff dedicated to that, and E! Network is really surviving off of that. So they're going to do any and everything that they can to make sure that this show is number one.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. Any and everything that they can. And I can't say it's the beginning of that, because I don't know if you remember back to like the Carmen Electra days when she was with Dennis Rodman and Pamela Anderson. They had a similar time.
They
weren't necessarily talented. I mean, she kind of did acting. She kind of
danced.
I mean, she kind of danced.
Carmen could dance, though. Carmen could really, really dance.
Yeah, but that's not what she was famous for. It's not. J-Lo was famous for some of her dancing, but she was really famous for, you know, she did more of acting.
J-Lo kicked down the door with the dancing and then learned how to do everything else as she went. Like, you know, they did it. I'm sorry, I'm going to interrupt you, but yeah, J-Lo, she started with the dancing, and then she figured out how, oh, can you do this? But can you dance and sing? Okay, Selena. Okay, can you dance, sing, and act? Okay. You know, so it's like she took one in front of, you know, and then made something out of the three as she got more popular in that one, which mm-hmm. is what Alexa was doing, but she didn't have exactly what J-Lo had.
So she had more of a sex appeal immediately because she did the Playboy.
Yes, I would agree.
Just like Pamela Anderson did the Playboy. Immediately, they were bad girl sex appeal. So, I mean, I think that's kind of one of the things that, you know, back in the 90s, it was enticing. And people followed them, and they followed, you know, who they dated and what relationships they were in, and their marriages and their breakups and who had an STD and all of that, you know, right? So,
but isn't that a transition from almost wanting to, you know, the entertainment now is finding out the personal lives of the people that were a little bit more distant? Isn't that the part of entertainment now? I mean, the fact is that, you know, we weren't entrenched with these people's lives. We didn't know their every single move. We wouldn't have been able to see the Beyonce fight, you know, blah, 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 in the elevator.
Yeah.
Isn't that what is, you know, craving us? And you said we're living vicariously. Isn't that the entertainment now that's more important than actually, you know, getting a good story?
But you know what I think a part of it is that we want to see that they have problems and they're somewhat normal like us. Like somehow that will validate our life or make them just as much as a human being as we are. So I think that's kind of one of the things that the Kardashians show you all the time is that, you know, they fight amongst themselves and they're somewhat normal. Like they try to pretend like they have a normal life. Mm-hmm. Everybody knows that their life is not normal. But when you saw the Jay-Z video and you were like, oh my God. And then all of a sudden Instagram went crazy and Twitter went crazy.
Yeah.
And everybody had a meme and everybody had a GIF and everybody had something to say. And we watched the video 15 times because it made them normal.
That's it. It makes them normal. Mm-hmm. That's really funny. But really, how is tabloid news and the whole, you know, popularity of chopping, how has it affected your business?
I wouldn't say that it's negatively affected it, because now you kind of have more opportunity to get your clients different places.
Okay.
But, you know, there's a ceiling. So if you're not, you know, this sexy or that person and you know, or in some type of scandal, then the ceiling is that you won't be on the front page of the People. You won't be on the front page of Us Weekly. It's just really a hard way to go in terms of that sort of level of celebrity. They're very particular.
Do you think about actually putting on a skit or some type of thing to create a spectacle? For instance, you guys remember the Jimmy Kimmel fire and twerking thing? Do you guys remember that about maybe 6 months ago?
I remember that one.
Well, it was basically, it went on YouTube, and it was this, you know, a fair-skinned white girl kind of twerking upside down on the door, and then she tipped over, and when she tipped over, something caught on fire, and then you see her running out of the thing going, ah! You know, and that's how it ended. And it created such a viral response, of course, that now you have major news networks, ABC, CBS, CNN, they're asking for interviews. And so they're asking for interviews, and then the next week on Jimmy Kimmel, he comes out and shows that this was all a stunt. This was all a skit to show you that, you know, you can attract all these major news networks and they're following this like news, but it's really just something we just manufactured. So do you ever think in that type of way for something in your client?
I've done it before.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Give me an example.
I'm not going to tell you exactly what it was because it's confidential. But, I mean, we've done some things like that before, and you do it to kind of get a buzz for your client. I mean, as long as it's, I would never do a skit like what Jimmy Kimmel did, but
yeah, upside down fire twerking.
Yeah, upside down fire twerking is probably a little bit out of my realm of possibilities.
But not today. Not today. Yeah. No, can't do it.
Yeah, but I mean, I have clients who've had fake relationships with bigger celebrities.
Wow.
And that's something that's actually really common. You know, I've had clients who had, like, you know, tips that really weren't real on reality television.
Yes.
Just to kind of get the ratings up or create some kind of buzz. So, I mean, it's something that happens a lot in publicity.
Wow. So now, if Ring was your client, you know, and you're dealing with somebody, again, he's multi-talented, you know, he can do the singing, the dance. What would you do to make sure that he gets the visibility he needs to not only sign a record deal, if that's the way to go, but at least start selling some records and then get him on more type of acting things? What would you do if he was at this stage in his career and he came to you?
Ugh. Well, I don't know that much about you, Rain. I'm sorry.
So, I don't really know you, brother. But,
yeah. Brother. And that's no shade. But, I mean, he seems like he's really talented. So, I mean, I hate for people who actually have a lot of talent to kind of do things that people who don't really have so much talent to do, like the schemes and things, because sometimes if your voice is like Tyrese in the Coca-Cola commercial,
I remember that.
Just be that, you know, and then make sure that everybody knows it, and that's okay, and that still. That still goes.
But like, now you're dealing with a client, you know, I'm sure Rain's not like this, but they're anxious. They feel their time is now. Mm-hmm. You know, they're not necessarily want to take the step-by-step program. They want to jump 5 steps in 1 hurdle because they seen somebody else do it, and I deserve it, right? You know, I'm the best.
Yeah, ain't nobody got time to be angry, though. Yeah, anger is just that's personal poison. So, like, I've learned that, you know, there's a special time for every emotion. And just knowing when that time is how you move through life. So being angry about what you feel like, you know, you haven't been blessed with yet, that don't feel right. That don't feel genuine. It doesn't move in a positive direction. So it's all about just doing the best that you do, the best that you know how to do it, and constantly improving. And when people see, like, I had a sit down conversation with Mr. Quentin Tarantino after the show, and he looked me dead in the eye and was like, yo, you are, the whole show is 45 minutes of you initially, and you hold the show up. And he gave me some amazing tips and talked about the business. And we've been able to talk about the business, but we talked about, like, life and legacy, and, like, the show that I'm in is the 20th anniversary of his movies. These are things that came out of his mind. And we're up here celebrating it 20 years later. And I talked to him about legacy and what he wanted to be known and left for. And it's like, it was amazing how earnest and how vulnerable people get when we realize we all just humans. It's not about making it, it's about doing what you do, finding that personal purpose in you and allowing that to resonate in other people. That's all it is. That's all passion is.
We're about to go to a break, Rain, but why don't you tell the audience where they can get a hold of you, where they can find you, where they can tune in. You're going to be at the Alexa.
I'll be on the other end of this phone. But definitely, you should. I will definitely make a trip to actually be in the studio audience. I really wanted to be there, but I appreciate you giving me the option to call in. You can follow me on Instagram, Rain the Artist. That's REIGN. Rain the Artist. It's not just a name. It's a decoration.
Okay.
Talking about, you know, starving artists. Time for the artist to rain. So, Rain the Artist. And Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, same thing. Rain Morton, REIGN. Morton like a salt, MORTON.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Rain, for taking the time out of your busy day. I know you got to go back to rehearsal, but we're going to get you in here and have a more one-on-one discussion, you know, about your plans and how you can manifest your realities in the future. So we'll talk to you soon.
Yes, sir, man. I'll bring you some chicken or something. I don't know. I feel like I should have brought something.
I'm going to miss the chicken.
I don't want to come into here, so I'll be like some chicken or something.
You can be on here again. We'll make sure it happens. All right, then. We're headed for a break. This is Mind, Booty, and Soul Live. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
A song and video on that magic screen. I wouldn't have it any other way. I close my eyes and say, I wanna be on MTV. I said, I wanted to be on MTV. Let me hear you say, oh.
We know there are many choices of internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Hi, this is Sequoia Neff.
And this is Jay Rios.
And I'm Sharon Moore.
Inviting you to join us every Monday at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time for Battle of the Sexes as we discuss his and her views on topics no one wants to touch.
Where we keep it 100% real.
And interesting.
And it is pure comedy.
So don't forget to tune in to Battle of the Sexes Mondays at 7 p.m.
Exclusively on LATalkLive.com and the Talk Live Broadcast Network. You can also catch us on iTunes, Radio R&B, Live 365, Radio Flag, and AHA Radio.
Or watch and listen directly at LATalkLive.com. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure.
This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hey, everybody, it's your man Sabir Bey back on your airwaves, inviting you to join us every Tuesday, 3 p.m. Pacific Standard Time on the Sabir Bey Show, discussing history, law, and hip-hop. Every Tuesday, 3 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, the Sabir Bey Show, exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You also can catch us on iTunes Radio and R&B, Live 365, Radio Flag, and now Stitcher Radio. Or watch us and listen directly at LATalkLive.com. Reality radio, handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hi, this is Dr. Levi, your fitness doctor, making a personal house call, inviting you to join me Wednesday at 10 a.m. Pacific for my all-new show, The Dr. Levi Show. Join us as we discuss fitness, health, and well-being, including emotional and spiritual health. So don't forget to tune in to the Dr. Levi Show every Wednesday at 10 a.m. Pacific, exclusively on LATalkLive.com and the Talk Live Broadcast Network. You can also catch us on iTunes, Radio R&B, or watch us on Ustream.tv, or catch us on the Live 365 Network, and now on Radio Flag and Stitcher Radio. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hi, this is Elena, inviting you to join me every Wednesday at noon for Elena's Beauty Talk and more, exclusively on LA Talk Live. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio, R&B, or watch us on Ustream.tv. Reality radio, handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hi, this is Starlet Quarles, and I'm inviting you to join us every Wednesday from 5 to 6 p.m. The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People. Join us as we discuss the topics that are relevant to today's generational leaders. So don't forget to tune in to The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People, every Wednesday from 5 to 6 p.m. right here on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B, Live 365, Radio Flag, and now Stitcher Radio. Or watch and listen directly at LATalkLive.com. Reality radio, handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
See, I can kind of recall a little ways back. Small trying to ball, always been black. And my hair, I tried it all. I even went flat, had a gumby curly top and all that crap. Now, just trying to be appreciated. Nappy headed brothers never had no ladies. Then I hit the barbershop real quick, had a gimme little twist, and it drove them crazy. Then I couldn't get no job. Corporate wouldn't hire no dreadlocks. Then I thought about my dogs on the block. Kinda understand why they chose to steal and rob. Was it the hair that got me this far? All these girls, these cribs, these cars. I hate to say it, but it seems so flawed. Cause success didn't come till I cut it all off.
Little girl with the pressing curl. AJ, I got a Jerry curl.
We're back. I just had to listen to those lyrics pretty good there. I was really into it. You know, the hair, you got real success when hair cut off. And everybody knows that I have locks, so I don't think I'll ever get to that point. But hey, maybe, you never know, right? The call-in number for you to dial in and actually tune in and have a conversation with us, is 323-473-3100. We're at LA Talk Live, and we're back on Mind, Booty, and Soul Live. One of the things that I really want to address as we come back is that the most important resource that I think we have in today's world is our attention. Everything is vying for our attention. You know, in traditional media, we had the newspapers, we had the television, we had the radio, but now traditional media has merged in with its new media, and you know, we got our devices, we got our notifications and our Instagrams, and everything is really distracting us. You know, it's right now our time, and our time to actually utilize these products is becoming more and more important, and it's becoming much more competitive. So I think we all have to really pay attention to where our minds are going and how we can focus on our accomplishing our goals. So one of the things I want to ask with you, I'm glad we're back here on this topic here, is now we looked at all the gimmicks that women are actually doing to actually, you know, sell their bodies. And if you look on Famous and 12, you know, one of the first things that they're doing is, you know, they're actually chasing celebrities, trying to get selfies with celebrities, trying to do gimmicks with their bodies as far as nudity. And, you know, we had the going a billboard ad, and all she was wearing was a little thing in front of her. So I'm sure you have female clients. Do you ever have that discussion about what they can use in their bodies to actually attract the attention? Because, you know, the sex tape, we all know about that, but it seems like that should be old school right now. But what are the type of conversations you're having with female, you know, clients?
Well, I always believe in morality.
Okay.
So I don't encourage my female clients to be scantily clad, to get a part or anything like that. There are other publicists who do, you know, encourage their clients to be a little bit more risque, because that's kind of what the image, the brand that they're building for themselves. I've been lucky enough to really work with women who want to have a really clean brand and not kind of go that route. But there have been instances where, you know, one particular client of mine was asked to be in King magazine, and she was pretty young, and she was attractive, and she had a really good show on a very popular black network. And when we were at this shoot, you know, of course they try and get you take off a little bit more, and then the next look is a little bit more, and we just kind of had to draw the line and have control over what they're able to publish, and what they're not able to publish, and how you want to be seen. And you know, it just really comes down to what you want your brand to be, mm-hmm. and how you want to build it. Because there are the women out there who, you know, who don't see a problem with Rihanna's dress, this totally see-through Crystal's dress. But then there are women who still do very well. I don't think Beyonce would ever wear that.
Okay.
You know? But she is risque in her own way, in a more classy kind of way. So it really just depends on what you want your brand image to be.
Now, what would you advise? You know, how would you talk to, you know, the whole king experience? Now, one of the things that I've been in those positions, mm-hmm. Is the eagerness and the yeah. youthfulness of yeah. the model or the particular female mm-hmm. artist. You know, I remember some situations where they're just so eager to please the camera.
Yeah.
And they're so, you know, want to be helpful and make sure the cameraman likes them.
Yeah.
And if the cameraman says, hey, you know, take off your top, and the cameraman mm-hmm. might be saying, I want you to be implied, but hasn't gotten there yet. They're just full free and just mm-hmm. ready to go. And, mm-hmm. you know, I've been on that, and I'm like the behind the scenes video guy, and I'm just like, wow. And they're youthful and they're young and they're innocent, and they're mm-hmm. just so willing just to expose themselves because they feel that that's what they have to do.
Mm-hmm. I would advise them that just because you go topless doesn't mean you're going to be the next Halle Berry. You know, it really just doesn't. There's no guarantees. There is a opportunity for you to learn something from that. If you did it and you're ashamed of it, or if you did it and you're not ashamed of it anyway, but it still hasn't taken you further, there's an opportunity to learn from that. But I wouldn't advise my clients to, you know, sell their soul for a printed copy of something, because next month somebody else is going to be printed. So what else is there? Mm-hmm. Like, what else do you have?
Yeah, yeah, I agree. But, you know, the pressure for young
it's
women.
Enormous, yeah.
Yeah, and then there's just so much competition. And, mm-hmm. okay, let's, for instance, you know, the work seemed to dwindle, especially around the strike, you know, 2007, the writer's strike, and then we had the economy.
Yeah.
You know, and it was already kind of doomsday for people of color.
Yeah.
You know, so it was a very slow period of time.
Yeah.
And so what were some, you know, in your imagination, what were some of people doing to kind of make ends meet during that period of time? I know in my world, they were compromising themselves.
Yeah. I mean, in my world, I would say that it kind of was a little bit still probably more consistent than, you know, in the television production world. Because
yeah.
in 2007, it also was, you know, a really big time for music.
Uh-huh. How so?
That was really around the time where the Kanye came out, like maybe a little bit before 2007. But it... hip-hop music was really, really, really growing in that time period. I would say probably from like 2002 to you know, now it's to be more common, even more common than it was in the late 90s, you mm-hmm. know? It was kind of making its second comeback for music. So a lot of people moved into that era, and then I think now people are taking a little bit more control of their own career. They... the record labels aren't passing out, you know, $1 million advance deals anymore.
Right.
You know, it doesn't happen. So they're starting their own labels, and they're, you know, then there's the World Stars, and there's the Media Takeout.
Yes, yes.
And there's the Boss Ups, and now the Loss Ups. Like, you know what I mean? Like, they're kind of figuring out a way to compete in a saturated media market that excludes them, especially for the African American community. So, I mean, I think for me, it's positive growth, whether it's, you know, some things that are very distasteful that you see on the World Stars or the Media Takeouts, but it's still a presence, and it's a presence that we didn't have before.
Well, it's interesting to bring up Halle Berry because, you know, she was a 10-year actor for mm-hmm. a good 10 years. She was really established. She was definitely in the urban lane. And when she decided to, you know, expand her brand to more of a wider audience, part of that process was showing her skin.
Yeah.
She did the Swordfish where she showed her breasts, mm-hmm. you know, and that was the first time she ever had done that. Mm-hmm. And then she goes right into Monsters Ball. And, mm-hmm. you know, a lot of people think that she got the Academy Award because
of that sex scene.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, right there, that's the blueprint. It worked for Halle, it's going to work for me, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But Halle did so much more before that. You she know did. What I mean? I'm a fan of Halle Berry. I don't really like the sex scene portion of it, but it was artistic and...
Was it?
I thought it was... I thought it wasn't as much as people made it out to be.
Oh, my God. It was looked very like a graphic. Portals. Yes.
But it's not something like... I think that we looked at it and we were like shocked by it. It was definitely shock value, but I don't think that it's something that hasn't happened already in non-African American, you know, with a non-African American person. I think that it's definitely happened before with a white actress.
Mm-hmm.
So
no, you're absolutely right.
And I just think that we looked at it a little bit more because it's like this brown lady and this white man, you know.
And this brown lady who has never done anything like that
this before, yeah.
And said she would never do anything like this. And
did she say that?
Oh, prior to making that decision to widening her audience, she came into like, I'm not going to do nude scenes, you know. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to put myself out like that to where, you know, wow, I get Swordfish. And, you know, there was rumors mm-hmm. that she got paid $500,000 just to show her breasts based upon that particular scene. And
well, then that's a really low rate because I don't even think that's high enough.
Oh, really? Okay. Wow. Okay, everybody has their price. So, you know, I would love to say what your price is, but, you know, I'm sure that's another topic. But now I want to get into, you know, the whole YouTube thing and mm-hmm. the technology. And, you know, I just had a conversation today where people are saying, look, why should I pay a publicist a certain amount of money and hope that they get me on? You know, mm-hmm. when I can just pay a fee to the servicing companies that's going to put my thing in the Boss Ups, in the World Star, and those type of affiliates, and it'll push my product out into that type of visibility, and it's guaranteed. Are you finding yourself competing with this kind of, you know, virtual online marketing PR machine?
I would say yes and no. Yes, you do have to pay for these services. Is there an instance where a publicist can get these things for you without you having to pay the service? Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
If you pay for these services, are you going to land in the same, you know, box and barricade that 50 other people have paid for it? Or are you going to be, you know, at the top of the page?
Uh-huh.
Above the fold is what they call it. Probably if you pay, you'll just be there. But do I think it's a great starting place for people who don't have the money to pay a publicist? Absolutely. I'm one of those people who say, try it out first. See what you can do for yourself and what level you can get yourself to. And if you can get yourself to a really good level, a publicist should be able to take you to the next level after that. So
you're willing to walk away from...
Absolutely. I have done it before.
Really?
I have.
Well, you are a woman of integrity.
I've actually advised people, you know... I mean, everybody doesn't have the budget to pay what I would require. Mm-hmm. So I'm not even going to waste your time. I can advise you on, you know, the steps that I think that you should take and what you can do on your own first. And then once you get there and you get your budget up, then, you know, then you can come back to my office. But some people, everybody doesn't need a publicist right away.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Some things you have to do on your own. Just like you back in the day when artists used to go to the mall and sell their tapes and CDs out of the trunk.
Yeah.
You start there first. You don't go and find a publicist first. You start there. And then once you know, have a name for yourself, then you go and find a publicist.
Now, your average person that gets off the bus and has been here for a couple of years,
mm-hmm.
you know, is their mentality willing to do the work to raise their, you know, publicity or their exposure or visibility to a certain level? Because, you know, there's a lot of social media.
Yeah.
And it's not only social media, but it's actually attracting their fans and keeping the rotation going. You've mm-hmm. got to provide a certain type of more than just, hey, this is what I'm wearing. This is what I look like. You know, you've got to provide some type of entertainment value. Mm-hmm. If you're a singer, you need to be showing that you're singing and coming out with new songs and mm-hmm. keeping that flow going. Do people have the fortitude to do that type of work, or are they just looking for somebody to save them and rescue them and take them to the next level?
A lot of people want to be saved.
Mm.
And I can tell you one thing is that a publicist, as hard as they work, we don't have a cape on our back, and we can't save everybody. And as sometimes as hard as you try and as many people as you pitch and as much placements as you get, it doesn't mean that your record or your show is going to be a hit show. I mean, some of that has to be organic.
Mm-hmm.
Because we've had clients at our firm who have been in the People's, and you know, we had them on every single rap show. We had them on the 106 in Parks and all of that, and their record still didn't do well.
Okay.
You know what I mean? And this was a new artist. For a new artist to do that, that's amazing placement.
Mm-hmm, it is.
They got the best of the best, but they still didn't do well. And that doesn't really reflect on
the music itself?
I mean, it has to reflect on the music itself. It has to reflect on what are you doing extra to make people feel like they're on your journey with you. You know what I mean? And that's not always a story that a publicist can tell. That's something that, you know, as an artist, you have to be invested in your people. You have to answer them when they Twitter you. You have to take the time and do a YouTube channel. It's really a all in or nothing kind of situation. But then there's people that I know, a good friend of mine's actually, his vines are like top rated, like he's like the king of Vine.
Okay.
Right? He has all of these little Vine videos, and he was on the cover of New York Magazine just because his Vine videos were insane.
He's getting
all these endorsement deals because he's the king of Vine now. He wasn't really, he's never had a hit show. He's never had a publicist. He's just grew organically. And sometimes that just happens.
Well, I think that that's becoming, you know, the formula or the prototype that, you know, you mentioned earlier that people need to get in the game and they need to get themselves to another level. Well, I think that's the prototype that you have to do now. That's mm-hmm. a requirement.
Yeah.
It's almost like you're supposed to take care of your children. Well,
yeah.
You know, if you're an entertainer, you're supposed to do the Instagram, you're supposed to have the Twitter, the YouTubes, and you're supposed to be feeding those particular, you know, machines on, you know, at least two or three times a week. And if you're not doing that, you're not really doing anything.
Yeah, you're not even in the game. Because people have an insatiable appetite and they want to constantly devour something new.
Devour.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that sounds like what men do here in Los Angeles when they see a woman get off the bug is devour her. You know, we love that innocent, fresh appeal that nobody's ever had a chance to see.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, and we want to take her and she wants to, she's all odd. So that's interesting that you would use that word devour. That's mm-hmm. pretty serious.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Well, you know, we're expecting another call. I guess we haven't got that yet. I was looking for John Patello. He's really equipped and informed and really just very well schooled on the whole YouTube thing.
Yeah.
I mean, what's happening now is that people are making their brand, they're building their audience, and they're getting some residual checks. Do you have that type of conversation?
Yeah, I always have that conversation. I think that... especially clients who are like kind of selling a service or something. Like I have a client who is a celebrity hairstylist.
Okay.
And as much as she would like to work on, you know, anybody in Augusta, Georgia, she can't go and do your hair. But she can do a YouTube video
mm-hmm.
and it could be a how to style it yourself. That somebody that's interested in her. So when she goes to speak in Augusta next time, that lady's going to come and see her.
Okay.
Or she might be able to sell her video on that page as well. So.
Okay. All right. So, you know, that brings me to a really key important ingredient, because I know that for YouTube, it's mm-hmm. really starting to work with me now.
Yeah.
As far as you start to do the diligence, you have to really do the description. I got this really 10-sheet list, and it takes a lot of time, but you start to see the numbers growing up.
You do.
And I don't think people are realizing, they're looking at the old traditional media like, hey, if I can get hooked on to this show and I can get somebody to tap me over here, you know, I'll be famous. But, you know, the new direction is to build organically, like you said,
mm-hmm.
build a network, you know, find people that work with you mm-hmm. that are doing similar things, and you're actually a grouping and you're actually getting the task done. You mm-hmm. know, Do you tell your clients that? Are they listening? How are they, you know, taking that information that you're trying to give them?
I do. Because one of the best things that you can do is lump your celeb with other celeb. Okay. You know what I mean? And then grow your audience together. So, like what Kevin Hart did with Think Like a Man.
Okay.
They put, like, it's almost like creating a successful movie, right? Okay. You want to have a star, right? But if you have all of these other people who are smaller stars but are from different sects, then you get a larger pool of an audience that you're tapping into.
Got it, got it. Right?
So even though, I hate to say this, no one necessarily thinks that Lala Vasquez is a great actress or anything like that. She has a totally different market than Kevin Hart or Gabrielle Union. She has the VH1 Teeny Boppers who loyally follow her. So they're like, oh, Lala's going to be in this movie. They're definitely going to go see it. They may not have went to see it before if it was just Kevin and Gabrielle, you know? So it's kind of like you need to do that as a talent. Lump your celebrity in with other celebrities and kind of grow as a platform. Record labels have done it for a long time when they have features, feature artists on a song. So it helps build not only the person that's featured, but it also helps bring your level of stardom higher, you know? So,
well, that's true, because actually, you know, the fact that I have this show and I'm bringing on, you know, talented people, you know, mm-hmm. I'm able to communicate with their fan base immediately. You know, I'm able to put something on Facebook and instantly goes to their people. You know, their people want to see this. Mm-hmm. So, you know, my friend's request went up today, you know, by about 10. And, you know, those things.
Because of me.
Because of you, because of Rain, because of all the activity that I'm doing talking about mm-hmm. this show. So I agree 100%. And the type of meeting I had today is find those other YouTube channels that are a little bit bigger than me that have a bigger audience and mm-hmm. do some collaborations.
Yep.
So it's always working within your network. Yep. But we live into such this individual, me, you know, I can do it by myself. We don't mm-hmm. really understand the team aspect that mm-hmm. we need to actually build a good network. Once again, it's mm-hmm. who you know.
I think that people who are in music get it. And I don't think that it's translated as much to people who are in television, film, actors and actresses. I don't think that they really get it as much.
Mm-hmm. Why?
Because it's so competitive. A lot of them are competing for the same roles because there's so many limited roles for African Americans that they're like, well, you know, unless I'm in the in crowd, I won't be able to get this role. I won't be, you know. And with music, I think that artists kind of all have a different kind of lane, and they might not be competing with each other as much because, you know, my album is dropping in August and this mm-hmm. person's album is dropping in September, so it only helps me to be on this person in, you know, in August because people are going to be ready for mine in September. You know what I mean? We don't have that same kind of, it's not the same kind of cycle in television and film.
But you would think, since it's so competitive in this lane with the limited amount of roles, that mm-hmm. look, it's wide open over here, you know, in the YouTube lane, you know.
Yeah.
I've been in industry shooting and for a while, not me, but if I was an actor, you know, I know people that, you know, other people that want to act, and I know other people with a camera. Mm-hmm. So you would think that I would come up with something that, you know, it allows me to work on my craft, you know, it builds that muscle on a continuous basis. You would think that would be an easy lane for them to identify.
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't know if they think that the money is in creating something for YouTube, or if they, you know, they always want to be behind a blockbuster, right? They want to be, now people are like tuning into what's going on Netflix, like Game of Cards or
House of Cards. And Orange is the New Black.
And Orange is the New Black.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, the, you know, now those are that's the new thing is to be on a Netflix show, or Hulu is doing it now too with original content. I think YouTube is going to get there, but I think they might have to separate themselves a little bit more and do like a YouTube Plus with just original content.
I can see them going that direction. So how do people get a hold of you? If they wanted to find a PR person and they wanted to find out a little bit more about how you can tailor make their particular brand and bring it out to the open space, mm-hmm. how could they get in contact with you?
Well, I give out my email address.
Okay.
I like people to email me.
You're real personable.
Yeah. So my email address is Jamila Cummings.
Spell it for you.
Jamila Cummings, Cummings, at gmail.com. If they check out my work, they can look at Jamila C on Twitter. And then my Instagram, I won't give that one out because it's kind of personal.
Okay. And that's Jamila. Mm-hmm. And the I is almost pronounced like an E, right?
You say E, but I think it's just like I, like vanilla. But
Jamila. Okay, that's good. Okay. All right, well, stay tuned. This is a very good show. Always look forward to some new videos on mindbootyandsoul.tv. Also, you know, my new website is coming out, Mind Fitness and Soul. We've been actually recording a lot of workouts, getting some personal one-on-one training. But most important, it's nutrition, nutrition, nutrition. 80% of your workout is what you put into your body, what you eat. So we'll be having those type of content, talking these things with these personal trainers. And you can get the insight. This summer's what? How many days is summer? Today is the 16th, 17th. 4 days away.
Oh, God. I have to go back to the gym today.
Oh, yeah. So, you know, hey, 4th of July is about 5 weeks away. Something in that nature. Actually, 4th of July is around the corner.
Yeah, it's 2 weeks.
Oh, my God. Wow. Summer is rolling around. So it's time to get our bodies right, but it's time to change our lifestyle. Stay tuned. We'll be back next week, every Tuesday at 7 p.m. for another episode of Mind, Booty, and Soul Live. Peace.
I just get off stage, I'm overseas. When you send a picture, cut off a face and cover up the tattoo by the waist. Let the MC search till I reach third base. And when I get home, I'ma hit home play. Wait, would this be considered a first date? Yay, the picture just looks so trash. Your body make a ball of spin, cook coke cash. Plus every good girl wanna go bad and pose in the mag like Stacey Dash or Kim Kardashian, be your lady at it. You know what's the crazy things? The girls that make your wait longer than AC Green. Passion of the Christ, 33-year-old virgin. That's disrespectful, baby, don't encourage him. I like them brown, yellow, Puerto Rican, or Persian. Dashiki, kimono, or turban. They say I dress right, but my swag's so urban. Trying my luck, I hit her with the text, said, baby, you up? Question mark, and she responded, yes, S-S-I-R. Literally, pun intended.
American booty for sale in every nation. American booty for sale in every nation. Mind, booty, and soul. American booty for sale in every nation. American booty for sale in every nation. American booty for sale in every nation.
Mind, booty, and soul.
Look at your girl. Who taught you how to love her?
Thank you for tuning in to LA Talk Live, reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we're more than just talk. Stay tuned.